see.
By the way, I love your picture in the background with the TARDIS. That is awesome.
Oh, thank you. What happened? It just went. It just went.
Yeah. Hey, everybody. No. I accidentally hit the button and we're live.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Oh no.
Hey, why don't we start the show?
Yeah, let's start the show.
Okay, I'll just stop doing what I was going to do, and okay. I will start the show now.
Sorry, Mike.
Shh. Make pretend like they don't see us. What, the three people, the one or two people that may be watching right now? Here we go.
Nothing happened. So, Mike, there was I hit the preview button, right? Which, because when you launch it on YouTube, you have to hit preview, and then it goes, okay, preview's good. Now you can start streaming. Well, normally, I don't do that until later, and I was being ahead of the game and getting it ready.
Yeah.
And then I went to go hit the preview button again and launch the show, so that's why there was that little beginning. Hey.
That's kind of like what I thought I did. See, I thought that I actually hit it, and I didn't hit it the second time. Right. So,
and you can't stop it, because once it starts, that's it. If you stop it, we have to reset everything up. So it is what it is.
Hey, now we're even.
That's right. Now we're even. Now we're even.
All
right.
So listen, real quick, because we got a lot to get into tonight. I have a word for you. Actually, I have two words. I've decided I'm going to do two of them. And you'll figure out why in a second. The word for you is spange.
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 Spange. All right, hold on. Let me think. That sounds like something like from like basketball, you know, like if it was a sponge, it'd be like a spange. It's not a Boston sponge. So, let me think. No. Spange. Spange. It does nothing to do with a foreign country.
No. Okay. No. And it's not even sexual for once. I was actually shocked. It's not sexual. So just.
Let's see.
So it's not a Spanish dog with mange.
No. Could be,
but it's not. As we all know, Spanish dogs get mange from being sexual.
They could.
Okay. So what do you say? Come on. Because I got a second word and then we got to get started. So what do you say?
Okay.
What do you say?
A spange.
Sounds like a type of tool to me.
Could be a tool. It's like it's strange, but in Spanish, it's like a strange Spanish person.
No, it's actually kind of a verb. You use it as a verb. Okay,
all right, but just tell me, I don't know.
To collect spare change, other from couches or the street. All right, Jimmy doesn't have enough money to go to the show. He'll have to spange.
Oh, nice. That's a good one.
And the other one, I think, I don't know if we ever talked about this before or not, but this one is outer course. Not inner course, but outer course.
This one is sexual, though.
As sexual as intercourse. Well, let's see, get the same results, I guess you could say.
Is it like rubbing?
Pretty much the opposite of intercourse, except with clothes on. It consists of male or female couple rubbing up on each other.
I didn't get the first one, but I got the second one.
Nope, and that's why I gave that one to you.
There's a joke about that, but we will not go into that story here.
And we're going to keep that inside.
Or outside.
I see what you did there. Without further ado,
yes, it did.
in a very strange way, I am going to start the show.
All right. Like a story from a far-off land told by many different authors, only not quite as good. That's right, it's time for the Mythwits, the show dedicated to all things geek pop culture drenched in absurdity and coated with sarcasm. Every week we bring you news and interviews from the Geekoverse. We do our damnedest to be funny, but there are no guarantees. We'll be attested to by anybody who's watched our show. I'm your host, Peter Bryan, and joining me this week is a full cast. We have my co-host, Mike Kafis.
Heyo.
Hal Greenberg. Richard Lee Byers.
Hello.
Kevin Glussing.
Gleasing, but yes. Hello, Gleasing. Everyone.
And Eric DeBye. Dibby
or not Dibby?
Dibby or not Dibby? And
that is the question.
Unfortunately, Doug was willing to join us, but Doug, there's not enough room down here. If you guys are watching the video, there's a spot. He would be right there.
Other side, Mike, or this side?
Other side.
Yeah, there you go. That's good.
This side, yep. Okay. Yep. Yeah, he'd be right there, but there's no spot there. Nope. And Doug wasn't feeling well anyway, so I think it works out for him.
Yes.
So, but I will mention him. Anyway, so guys, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Yeah, tonight we are talking about The Awakened 2, which is an anthology. You know, it's funny, guys, when BJ had first approached me with this, for some reason I thought it was a role-playing game that you guys were talking about. And then it turns out that there is role-playing element to it, but it's actually an anthology, which is cool. Because we've been having a lot of role-playing stuff on, and it's nice to break it up a little bit with some...
role-players who write books.
Yeah, role-players write books. There you go. Right.
Exactly.
Yeah, excellent.
That's us.
So let's get started with this. So this takes place in Grimaton?
Grimaton.
Grimaton, okay. What is that? It looks like an island.
It's basically a giant landmass with a bunch of littler islands surrounding them. And the idea is the books right now are focused on that mainland. And okay. As we kind of are able to expand, we're going to go into kind of discovering with the readers the outer islands. The mainland is human only, and there's no magic items, it's the only magic is those of them who may be awakened. The outer islands will be the opposite. There's going to be a lot of cool themes, some non-humans. Some of the islands will be all non-humans, and there will be some magic available there. And the reason why we're doing that is because we are also working on turning it into an RPG setting, and that will give the ability to keep it straight up like the books, mm-hmm. or if you want to add in some of the sides, but we'll be doing fiction with the sides as well. But that way it really lets people customize their game if they want to, and how they want, you know, if they're only interested in certain parts of the world as well.
Okay. Now you mentioned awakened. What is an awakened exactly?
An awakened is somebody, it's a very rare event in this world. And basically what happens is in that 0.01% when you're 19, there's two moons. And when the two moons cross on your birth month, you may become awakened. And when you do, you'd be awakened one of two different ways. Is you're awakened to a specific sphere of magic. And by that, I mean literally just fire or just ice or wind themed. And like you were mentioning, the gaming mechanics, when I created the world, I was thinking game mechanics, so I came up with the term that I use with everyone is mental constitution, mm-hmm. where you can only use so much magic and then you may need to take a rest or even pass out. Therefore, the people who have magic are not just overpowering everything all the time. The other option is you become basically befriended to an awakened sentient creature. They become sentient, so they have the human intelligence, and you can mind speak with them as well. So you can literally, truly communicate with them. And it's only one creature. It's not the entire, you can't speak to all, rats. It's that one specific rat and or lion or bear or wolf. But based on that, you can have creatures great and small, and the stories really reflect a lot of that uniqueness, which is what I love, because the people – have done from the littlest creatures to some of the largest creatures. And I really think because of the speaking, you can really put personalities into the creatures, which is fun to do.
So let me ask you this. Is it the person that's awakened that can talk to the creature? Is the creature awakened, or is it a little bit of combination of both?
I consider it both. Okay. And in the Bible, so to speak, of the world, if your human does die, the creature stays sentient, but won't be able to communicate. So it'll still be an extremely intelligent whatever it is.
Oh, that poor thing, man. It's I can talk, but I can't talk to anybody.
Well, or he could sit there if he's a rat or something. He could possibly take the rats onto a, grab them, and this is the boss rat. Let's do it.
Oh, so he could talk to the other rats.
Still. Well, he's a rat, so if he can communicate with the other creatures, some creatures definitely go. So, yeah, so there's a little bit of that which you can use too. If you have a smaller animal that tend to go in groups, you can't speak to the whole group, but your creature might be able to.
I see.
Or influence them.
Well, you know, I could see with dogs it'd be cool, and maybe with cats or whatever, but the rats, that's not going to be cool. The other rat's going to be like, oh, look at him. There's the human-talking rat. I don't like this rat.
Well, hopefully he's smart enough not to tell him, and he'll just be like, there's food over here. That's a good idea.
Right. Yeah. All right. That's cool. That's really cool. I like that. So in the picture, on the cover of your book, you have a lion. You have this big black lion on the front. And I'm assuming that that's representing one of the awake. He's probably an awakened because he's hanging out with people.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
The cover for book two has my characters on there, and I always laugh. It's a twofold thing. One is I did create the world, so I tend to use my guys on the covers for the first couple, but two is I knew that that story was going to be, and that story I knew was going to be made, so I could order the art in advance, so it was kind of a double-edged thing. There's the human who's more like a ranger-type character. He's a hunter in the world, and he becomes awakened to the lion, and I really, as much as I enjoy, and I'm not trying to suck up to anyone in the room, but I enjoy the other guy's stories better.
Okay.
I think they're great writers. I love my relationship with my character and his lion. He's kind of like he acts kind of pompous and like treats the humans like he's better. So
right.
I kind of like that feedback where he's a little sarcastic and likes to jab them a little bit and calls them two-leggeds, and stuff like that. And then the other one is a female who has a power over plants and trees and like living things like that. And that's why you see her with the staff and some roots and stuff.
I see. Okay.
I'm checking the actual cover myself. Yeah, there's some roots coming up from the ground.
All right. So
sort of druid powers.
Yeah. Correct.
A little bit, yeah.
Okay. So that was Awakened, the first Awakened, and then Awakened 2.
I continued those characters into Awakened 2.
Okay.
And they're also on the cover. And what I did was, we had another publisher for the first Awakened Kickstarter, and he's had some issues and could not continue going with us, so I got the rights back to everything. But we also had a deal with a bunch of artists to do their interpretations of the characters already, so I actually have four covers, and right now we're on book two. So hopefully we'll be funded and it'll be popular enough that we can keep going, because we all have some more stories to tell. Yeah, so those guys are pretty much on the first four, and then after that, people will know who's staying and going, and we can definitely get more variations on the front. But what I did is, speaking of role-playing, is I grabbed, for book two, three, and four, I grabbed some TSR classics and asked them to do their interpretation of those characters. So book two has Tony Szczudlo, who was pretty much the lead artist and the cover artist for all of Birthright for TSR.
Right.
Book three has a Jeff Easley cover, who pretty much did all of second edition, who did all the second edition books, or D&D stuff. And then book three has Fred Fields, who also did a lot of cover work and magic cards and stuff. They all did for TSR. So I kind of brought back a lot of the classic guys who I loved growing up and had them do their interpretations of the characters.
Awesome. So Ed Greenwood has been
Correct.
On our show. Did you say he was writing for this one too? Or,
yeah,
cause I
he wrote
for the first one.
He's in this one. And
how's he doing that?
He is the most prolific person I've ever spoken to in my life.
So what doesn't Ed Greenwood write for?
Because we had him on the show.
He writes in his sleep.
About this line of books that he's writing, right?
Yep.
It's like, we're gonna write 5,000 books.
Yeah, I'm actually helping with some of the Helm Hall with a short story or two, too. And I think actually a lot of the guys here are part of it, too. But the story about Ed that I love to give is the day before the book, when we thought the publisher was moving forward, where we had a deadline for book two's short stories, he emails me, and it was a Saturday. He emailed me Friday afternoon and said, oh, my God, when's the deadline? I think I'm late. And I said, no, it's tomorrow, but don't worry, because I always build in some relief time. I woke up that next morning and there was a 5,000 or so word edited short story in my mailbox from him. And he does work full time.
Wow. That's like a second level spell slot for him. That's not a big deal.
Right, exactly. And I'm sure he actually finished someone else's story that night before he went to bed too.
Exactly.
He's amazing. And a lot of these guys are. I mean, I do work full time, and this is something. So I do have to sit and train myself and turn off Facebook and really focus to do my stuff on the weekends or nights. And that's one of the reasons why, honestly, I chose the anthology. When I first was offered a book, I was offered an entire book. And I don't know if you can tell, but it's kind of like exercise for me. If there's not someone right over me telling me to exercise, it's not going to happen. And as you can tell, it did not happen. And that's kind of the way the book would have been. I knew that I would have eventually got it done, but I also knew that it would be kind of like George R.R. Martin, except I don't have that fan base to be able to wait forever. So I pitched, I've got a great idea for a world. It's kind of unique. Would it be okay if I did an anthology instead? I'll write one of the stories and I'll direct everybody and make sure we're all in the same place. Can we do that? Is that okay? And he said, sure. And then I started talking to my friends since I've been in the RPG industry for 17 or so years. I just figured out today. You meet a lot of people, and the science fiction, fantasy, and even role-playing, and even board gaming and card gaming, which we're doing now, it's one of the greatest industries to play in, because really there's not anger or angst or competition, because everyone can win and everyone can have a really great book. So everyone's very supportive and very cool and fun. So when you ask people, they're going to be quite honest. Yeah, I'd love to do it. I don't have time. But, you know, I can't do it, but blank maybe be able to. Right. And that's kind of what happened and how it worked. And that's how it worked with the RPG stuff, too. I love it. And I love the community. And I love working with my friends. I mean, it's really that part's really a blessing.
Okay. All right. Well, hey, Hal, we got a bunch of other people in this room, so I'm gonna nag somebody else. Let me pick on somebody
Please
else.
Please do.
Let me pick on Eric. Eric, what are you doing with the project? What's your role in all this?
Well, I wrote Hal a couple of stories. I wrote a standalone story in the first Awakened anthology, which kind of wraps itself up. It's kind of a mythic fantasy sort of story where it's like a fairy tale that someone would tell. And we were talking earlier about what happens to an animal who's been awakened to a human after that human dies.
Right.
And, you know, they go on being intelligent. And sometimes that doesn't go well. Mm-mm. Sometimes they go mad with the loneliness and whatnot. And that features into my story.
Well, that's good.
In an interesting
I like
that.
Way. That's cool.
It's so, largely so about
like
this.
What I was touching on before, they can, like, talk to this one human. Right. So
exactly. So now this, it's a bear, is isolated off in the woods by itself, unwelcome in human society, but, you know, still has that connection to humanity.
Well, and he knows how to steal their food.
And starts hunting the local human tribe.
Oh, that's not good. That's not Yogi the Bear at all.
No, not at all. And so groups of young people who gain these awakening powers go out and hunt down the bear and try and kill it. Every generation or two this happens.
Right.
And so my main character is part of this group. And he's expecting to be awakened to some great and powerful animal. And it doesn't go quite like he expects. So,
hey, boo-boo.
Good little story.
Those aren't the picnic baskets.
So, and then Hal was like, all right, that was great. I want another story from you. And I'm like, oh, crap. I just finished that one, and I wrapped it up. So I could tear it open and write about that tribe of people again, but I went a totally different way. So we're all gamers. We've all played D&D in games and stuff like that. Who hasn't wanted to play a thief with a ferret familiar? Right?
Oh,
right?
Oh, yeah.
That's what my story is about. It's fun. So that's cool. My story in the second one.
Awesome. All right.
And my characters are just never-ending smartasses around each other. It's pretty great.
It's a very good relationship. I really enjoy that relationship as well.
Nice. Okay, so Kevin, yes. Why are you here, Kevin? Tell us why you are here.
I ask myself the same thing every day. So I helped to bring the second Awakened together with doing the layout and things of that nature. I work with Samurai Sheepdog actually as the RPG manager and lead designer. So I'm collecting my own Awakened authors and writers in order to try and bring together some of our RPG stuff. In this book in particular, I wrote the story Change, which is about a character who kind of awakens to a power that's sort of unique even amongst Awakened, which I can't go into too much detail without spoiling the story, but he basically will learn his power, learn how to manipulate it, and eventually gain some power before it all falls down around him. So,
okay,
we'll see how that goes for him.
All right.
Yeah, other than that, just continuing to keep up helping out with the Facebook and Kickstarter and everything for the Awakened.
So, let me ask you this. So you are going to translate, you're going to be responsible for translating this into an RPG, right?
That's correct, yeah.
Yeah, I feel sorry for you. That is always a pain in the ass. So,
no, not for me. I absolutely love aspect of it.
It's just a lot of work. It's a lot of work.
It is a lot of work.
Are you going through, you have to go through all the stories and like take notes like, okay, well this can do this and that can do that and oh look what this author did. I better put that in the game and
I've got already an entire Word document just sitting at my desktop that I go in and I comb through for things, comparisons of, you know, oh the barbarian class does this and this guy has a monster that does this and you know, just things of that nature. A lot of technical stuff, but in the long run, it's going to be really cool to be able to open up the RPG when it's done and say, all right, you know what? I like this character from Eric's story with his ferret. Let's see what we can do with that.
Okay. So do you ever have to go back to them and say, hey,
I'm going to need you to tone down this thing.
What's that?
Like, I'm going to need you to tone down this. You know, you're reaching the upper end of what the dice system is going to be able to do on this.
Your character's not that level.
Yeah.
Actually, it's funny. I haven't had that issue just yet. We're just in the really beginning phases, but we're using a concept that was put together kind of by Clinton Boomer, who's another one of the authors in the book, and we're using that to kind of breathe out different ways of making character awakened. So there's not just going to be a single awakened class, but actually several options for you to take your character and have them awaken into these powers.
Okay.
Yeah, so that'll be a really fun way to explore it. My goal in the long run, it'll look like some of the older books that Hal and some of the others have done for Mystic Eye Games called The Player's Advantage, where it gives you so many different ways for you to make the different characters that you like that hopefully you'll be able to pick up the book, find a story, and say, I'd like to play a character like that. Cool. Or I'd like to play somebody completely different that hasn't been seen yet in the stories.
Right, right. And what system are we looking at? What gaming system are you looking to do?
So my primary ability to write in these systems involves Dungeons & Dragons, which is currently in the 5th edition.
Okay.
Also Pathfinder.
Okay, so this will be a Pathfinder / 5th edition game book?
Absolutely.
Okay.
It'll be two versions of it, both of which will have the same ideas, maybe represented in different ways, since there isn't a lot of crossbreeding between the two. But
very nice. All right, so hold on, give me 1 second here, Richard. I was moving left to right. You're not last because of any reason other than you were all the way right on my screen.
So,
Richard, what is your part in this project?
Well, I came on board with the new anthology, Awaken 2, and a lot of my fiction kind of lives in the dark fantasy / horror area, so I decided to do a story like that, and it's about a beggar with a bad leg who lives a really wretched life until he's awakened, and at which point he discovers that he can detach his shadow and send it off to operate independently and run errands for him and spy for him. And he starts using that to power to improve his life, and it goes really well for a while, and then later not so much.
All right.
And in the course of this, I noticed when I was going over the source material that there was a part of the continent that had been developed quite a bit, and then a part of the continent that had not been developed very much at all. And when I first go to a new shared world, new shared setting, I kind of like to go work a part where a bunch of people haven't done stuff already, partly because you know, there's less research to do. You don't have to worry quite so much about getting everything right. So I asked Hal if I could create a new town in this area, and he gave me the great compliment of saying, yeah, I could add a new town to his world. Right. And I did a town which is kind of very loosely impressionistically based on classical India, which is kind of milieu I'd never written about before. So that was a lot of fun.
Okay. So he's kind of like an Indian beggar. Does he have a fake leg or bad leg?
He's got a bad leg.
Bad leg, okay. And he can detach his shadow and send it out to do things. Now, this sounds to me like a Twilight Zone-y kind of story. Does it have that kind of feel to it? It sounds like it would be a great Twilight Zone type
story. Yeah, I think it does have that kind of feel. It's like you desperately wish for the magic power that'll change your life, and then you get it, but you didn't really know all the ramifications of having it.
Oh yeah, that's totally Twilight Zone. That should be cool. That'd be really neat. All right, so Hal, back to Hal, the ringleader of the group. So let's talk about the Kickstarter a little bit. So this Kickstarter kicks off when?
The 23rd, so Thursday.
Thursday, sweet. Okay, excellent. So the 23rd, and how long is it running?
30 days. It'll be till I think that Friday.
Okay. And have you got it all designed and everything? Is it ready to go?
It's pretty much ready to go. We're tweaking a little bit some of the tiers, the custom tiers. I'm waiting for photographs of the items to give people examples. I wanted to have specific examples ready, so I'm having people work on them, and they should be done today, tomorrow-ish. So that'll be all the written stuff is pretty much good to go, and it's in there. I think the only thing we're going to do is tweak some hyperlinks. But no, it's good to go. We're asking for $47.50, and that's really to pay the authors, to pay Tony for the cover and some of the interior art, and to get enough money there for the printing.
Okay.
And then, of course, Kickstarter fees and all that other great stuff. And then
Amazon.
Yeah.
Didn't they just up that recently?
I think it's around the same. I don't.
Something, don't they now?
I think it's still at eight total. It's like five and three, I think. It's right. Five from Kickstarter and three from Amazon. I'm 99.9% sure. I just averaged a 10 between those and then potential losses of sales. It's just easier to say 10.
Yeah.
But 10%. So, so we've got all that going. And once we hit the $47.50, people are already going to start getting bonuses. We will already have one story that'll be a PDF sent to people if it funds, period. And then we obviously will... You can get up to three additional stories. And then we have the option to get it on Audible to do an audio version.
Yeah.
Guarantee a book two in 2017, not just a guarantee, but we'll have it out next year.
Book three even.
I'm sorry, what?
It's in book three even.
Yeah, book three. Book two is now, sorry. Yeah, so guarantee that 2017 book three will be out. At the higher range, we'll be able to actually do a full comic book to expand a gift that I did for everybody. We did have a previous publisher for book one, and the end portion of that Kickstarter did not go as well as we liked, which is one of the reasons why we're handling it ourselves. So as a little thank you, every person who backs it will immediately get a five-page mini comic called The Pursuit, which I had CAE Comics work with me on that. In fact, two of the writer and the inker and other writer in that comic division of CAE is actually some of the people doing the stretch goal stories. So we're going to be able to have some guys who write fiction but in a different format actually be writing fiction for us. And they have some really fun ideas, I think, so that I'm looking forward and hoping those get funded so we can see those stories from those guys. So every person's going to get the comic book. Five-page comic book as a thank you right away, even if it's the $5, which is, for the ebook. And you can go up to soft cover, you can go to hardcover. Some of the neater tiers and more unusual is four of the five pages of the comic art, the original, are all signed, and you'll be able to buy those if you wanted those, and there's pictures on the site or on Kickstarter. We're going to have custom Funkos made of your favorite Awaken character.
Okay. What's a Funko?
The Funko Pops, the little... guys with big heads.
Oh, yeah. Okay, okay, right.
Yeah, okay. We're going to have some custom guys who do custom for a living. If you wanted to have – if you fell in love with Dex, like Eric's character, and you wanted to have him – or her, I'm sorry. We could set that up, and we'll do a one-off for you on that. Also, we have Martin Dunn, who's the one of the artists on the comic book, is willing to do a commission of an original Awakened character for you, one of a kind, full color, 11 by 17, just one of the many things. And then, of course, you always have to have your $10,000 tier, so I'm calling it Weekend at Hallie's.
Yeah.
Weekend at Hallie's is where I'll fly you and a friend into Tampa, where I live, and we'll hang out for the weekend. You'll get a case of books, couple Funkos, all that stuff. But if you can make it in the end of October, that's also when Necronomicon is here, as well as MegaCon Tampa Bay. I will get you into those as with me as my guest, and you can hang out with me and Ken Chan, another author, and Richard is always at Necro, so we'll be able to kind of hang out with some of the authors and do a bunch of stuff and just have some fun. Don't think anyone will take us up on that, but if they do, I am ready to hang out for a full weekend and get you a hotel room.
You've got
to
have the pie in the sky goal.
Exactly.
You never know if anyone will do it.
It'll be pretty cool to see somebody get in there and hit, you know, four of our stretch goals with a single sweep.
Yeah, well, if Elon, you know, decides he wants to take a little bit of time away from Tesla and come over for the weekend to Tampa, because I'm sure he wouldn't do it on his own, you know, he's more than welcome to buy the 10K tier, and we'll take care of Mr. Musk. Yeah.
You know, when I was a kid, I lived in Tampa for a couple of years. And
sorry.
I live in Baltimore now, so I mean,
yes, it's, sorry.
It's kind of a sister city to Tampa. But my favorite thing from Tampa was the Gasparilla Parade.
Yep.
I thought that was the coolest thing ever. And how old are you, Hal?
I have only been here for about 10 or so years, but I'm old. I'm 49.
Well, I'm 46. So you wouldn't remember Dr. Paul Bearer, who was the creature feature host in Tampa.
I do.
Back. You?
Yeah, Richard's local too.
I do.
He was the best creature feature host ever.
He was awesome.
Yeah, he was great. He was awesome. And I remember, so putting the two together, remember he was at the Gasparilla Parade. He was on a hearse thing. It was cool. Anyway, sorry, I don't want to derail the conversation.
That's fine.
So your Kickstarter goes off
Thursday.
June 23rd, this Thursday. It's going to be 30 days. Your tier started at 5 and worked their way up.
Yep.
So it's something I think anyone can afford, really. But let's say, and we just find Awaken 2 on Kickstarter.
That's the best way to search it, or you're more than welcome to, you know, friend me on Facebook at, The Real Hal Greenberg. I have a little Powerpuff version of me with my dog next to me.
Right.
I couldn't find a sheepdog, so it's just a regular dog for the little cartoon thing. But I'll have links up, you know, obviously on my own personal page. But, right. Yeah, Kickstarter, do a search starting Thursday night. It'll be going off around 8 Eastern for Awaken 2, and we should be pulling up. I think the image will be the cover, which is the, like you were saying, it's actually right behind me right there. It's the gentleman, the lion, and the lady. So it's kind of a unique piece, I think.
And Mike, is image one up?
Image one has been up, yes.
Which way is it? This way?
That's that way, yes.
Okay, so if you're looking right there, that's the cover. So.
Well, I think that's the Awakened one you gave me. I don't think that's the Awakened two.
Oh, that
two.
Is the Awakened one, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know what? I don't think I sent you a separate image. I just gave you the book.
That's fine. No, that's fine. But that was Awakened one. But anyway, you could find all these links there, and I'm gonna read them out in a minute, but they're all down here. If you click on just about any of those, it'll probably get you to the Kickstarter, because I'm sure everybody in our chat will be talking about it on their
and pages. I went and looked at the Kickstarter, or looked for it. I didn't realize it wasn't up yet. But if you wanted a preview, you can go to Drive-Thru Fiction. And there's a little preview for it, and I think you guys have a video ready to go on it too. So you guys want to check that out. It also, Hal, I would highly suggest that you get a short URL. If you need help with that, I can do that. I can help you with that. But get a short URL for your Kickstarters. It would be something like, you know, bit.ly/ The Awakened or something like that, you know, and or something that's not taken.
If you could send that to either one of us, we could probably, that would be a big help, so then we can use it.
It won't be able, if you remind me, if you send me something, or Pete, to remind me when it goes live, because I won't be able to do it without the actual link.
Right, without the link itself.
Just send it to Mythwits, you know. @gmail.com and we'll hook you up.
Yeah, we're happy to help. Yep.
Excellent. Awesome. And then and of course, if you guys want to, when we get this video edited, this interview portion, you can stick it right on your Kickstarter page if you like. You're fully welcome to do that, and people can hear all about it.
Yep, we'll be more than happy to, and we'll also link it in our Facebook pages and all that good stuff, too. Yeah,
cool, cool. All right, excellent. Well, is there anything else we want to say before we move on to the game?
Sure. One thing I did want to say, I wanted to give you a scoop. It's really hasn't been announced yet, but this afternoon, just to talk about the franchise of The Awakened, we just got signed with eSpec Books, who currently has a Kickstarter called Defending the Future live for a couple more days. They've just signed The Awakened Modern for February of 2017 Kickstarter. Awakened Modern is going to be the same rules of magic and powers, but in actual modern day Earth.
Oh, cool.
So it'll it'll be more of an adult. I always consider The Awakened Fantasy more of a PG. Mm-hmm. This will be more of an R. Language, a little pushing the limits. And one of the stretch goals of that, I'm also happy to say, will be Richard. He's already agreed to do a stretch goal story if we can hit it. And Eric is actually in the book as well. So a lot of the guys here have just found that out a few hours before you guys, but we're real happy that they picked it up. It'll be a little less stressful for us, and that way we can also get more books out for The Awakened, because if we can get book two guaranteed to fund next year, you'll get two Awakened books next year, so that'll be great.
Now, that's 'twould awesome. Be a pirate episode, pirate story you'd be writing. I would want it rated R.
There you go.
No, but I love this idea of telling stories and RPGs, like, meshed together. The genre is just so perfect for that. I mean, it's absolutely perfect. Because an RPG is just a living story that you're telling, you know, and if you have stories to go along with it, it helps people who are playing the game, you know, they get to read the story, and then they understand the world, you know, intimately. And especially with an anthology, you've got different authors writing, so you're getting different viewpoints and all kinds of different stories.
Well, that's what I love, is because of the different viewpoints and stories, you're not focused on only two or three of the characters, and you get a little bit of information on other side characters.
Right.
You're learning about the different areas of the world and what happens in them, because in some areas, Awakens, and some powers, Awakens are considered heroes and royalty, and in some areas you're banished because somebody may have had a bad power once, and now if anyone's awakened, you've cursed our area, you're out. So it's really kind of interesting to see, and I love the take that everyone takes on their characters and where they take it, and it really, like you said, it makes it a living world. You really feel like you could be in there, or you associate with one of these characters or the other, and that's what makes it so fun for me, is I love seeing what other people have done in my playground. It's just, I love it. And these guys have been great in book one and book two, and hopefully in the other books. I cannot tell you how awesome it is working with friends who are also extremely, extremely talented.
Fantastic. All right, guys. Well, thanks for joining us, and good luck. Good luck, sirs, with your Kickstarter. But we'd like you to stick around. We're going to play a game. We're going to play a little game.
All right.
So don't go anywhere.
Kevin, don't embarrass me.
I'm trying too hard not to embarrass myself.
Okay.
No, it'll be fine. Mike!
Mike!
Show over to you.
All right. Hey, gentlemen, we are going to actually be piloting a new game. We have had a game in the past that we call Bet the Geek. And this particular game is where we would have a video that our panel would watch. And it would be of myself asking the person on the video questions of a geek-type nature, like trivia. And then the panel, as you all would guess if they were going to get it right or not. And it was very tenuous, not tenuous, what is it?
Time-consuming.
Time-consuming and arduous work editing those videos. And so I just got this stupid idea the other day, like, Pete, why don't we just do it, like, live? So we're going to do this. Now, there are four of you, and you all are going to be competing against each other. Pete is going to be the geek, and you are going to bet whether Pete is going to get a question that I'm going to ask him right or wrong. Now, Pete, what I want you to do before we move on.
I think it's important.
We're going to say that after. What? No, okay. What?
All right, go ahead. I'm sorry. I'm stepping on your toes. Go ahead. Go. Oh. Sorry.
Listen, you're the contestant. You got to be quiet.
I need to shut up.
Whack. Shut your pie hole. No. what I want you to do right now, though, Pete, unless it's something urgent that you must get out, like, you know, how I'm going to screw something up, you may speak then. No, go ahead. No. All right. So go ahead and just tell the panel, because we were talking a lot of business, so I don't think people got your true personality. And as what's important is that people really get to know the the true you. Just, you know, tell people your likes, your dislikes, you know, what you prefer as far as outer course or intercourse.
Are you going to give me any sample questions so the group can gauge my geekitude?
Well, that was those two words at the beginning.
The two what?
The two words at the beginning.
Spain.
Right. Oh, Spain.
Well, what that's we right. need is like your fanish resume, so we know what stuff you like and what stuff you don't like.
Okay. Well, so all right. So I do. I like sci-fi. I like a lot of sci-fi. I am a. I like. So, for example, I like Star Wars. I'm not a fanboy of Star Wars. I like Star Trek.
You're wearing that shirt, and
I know. I like the shirt. I do like the shirt, but I'm definitely not anywhere on the level of some of these guys. You know, some guys who are really into it. I do not own a lightsaber. I don't own any Star Wars toys. This is like, I think this is the paraphernalia I own, just because I thought the shirt was cool. It's like an engineering shirt. I'm an engineer, so I'm an engineer. I'm very science-driven, science-oriented. I know a lot about a lot of science-y things. I'm not the biggest consumer of fantasy stuff. I do like some fantasy stuff, but I haven't read a lot of – I'm like very – you know, my geek card should be pulled for a lot of the fantasy stuff that I have not read yet, although I have read Moorcock and I've read
– More what?
Moorcock. Moorcock. I read Moorcock.
And Michael Moorcock. I don't think I have any questions related to
the eternal champion, not Outer Course.
Right. And I have, I've read a bunch of Burroughs stuff and which is sci-fi fantasy somewhere in there. I of course read Tolkien. So I got some geek cred.
All right, let's do this.
When it comes to RPGs, I've done.
He's a bit of a savant.
I'm a little bit of a publishing knowledge savant.
Okay, RPGs. When's the last time you played, and what was the last system you played?
Every Friday, and right now we are playing a system called Time Lords, which was by BTRC, but it's using that's the system that we're using, but it's we hacked it. We're actually playing Interface Zero laid on top of Time Lords.
Okay.
But yeah, we play every Friday.
All right. Yeah. So I think your geek card is there. You're good.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah. It is. Definitely. Trust me.
Yeah.
Now if you were talking sports, not so much. Okay.
Well, I'm there too, so.
So here we go. Here's what I've done, Pete. And I don't know. Yeah, I'm gonna allow you to do this. I'm in the middle of the document. You can tell me I'm somewhere in the middle, not the exact, okay? You can tell me this page. Scroll up or scroll down, and I have my mouse set on infinite scroll, and you will tell me when to stop.
We have a document with like 1,000 trivia questions in it. And to be fair, I have gathered this trivia. This is from my document. But also to be fair, some of these questions I haven't seen in 4 or 5 years.
Yeah.
And when I put them in, I had to look them up and then promptly pretty much forgot them after I wrote them down.
Yes.
So let's do the next page.
Well, I'm going to say scroll down, and you say when to stop. Okay, here we go. And go.
Stop.
Okay. Now, pick a number between 1 and 7.
Let's do 7.
All right. Oh.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write down my answer. I'm going to write down my answer, and then you guys just have to guess whether I'm going to – we'll go around the table, and you guys got to guess whether I'm going to get it right or not.
Okay, right. So
– we're not really betting.
What's that?
So we're not really betting.
Well, me and you are because we're close.
Let me explain how this will work because we're going to do this more of the video style. There are 3 versions of playing this game. It is called Cube of Death. So how this will work in this instance, since we are actually doing a play test of this, is each of you can bet up to 3 points, okay, in the he gets it right or he gets it wrong, okay? Right. And you will receive an equal
most
amount.
Most points win.
Most I'm sorry? Points wins.
Yes.
All right.
Gotcha.
All right. So.
But you, Mike, we're starting with, but everybody starts with 10, right? Because that way you can lose points if you bet three.
That's, we can try that for now. That's fine.
Yeah, that's how we do it.
Okay. So,
okay, so we have 10 points.
You have 10
so
points
we can bet
right
up
now.
To three.
And right. You can bet up to three.
Except
if you get down to zero, you're out, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Then we it escalated and we're death in the cube.
Yes. Right. Okay. All right, Mike, let's
do it. This game needs more mechanical development.
Yeah, it's
well, that's why we're doing a playtest of the live version of it because
all right, let's
you guys are the guinea pigs. Let's
now,
do it, Mike. Read me a question.
Okay. I've been trying to say this for a few minutes now. We have a problem, not a problem, but this is a six. This is a, what do you call these? A volley. So
no,
actually.
Just go to the next one. Just
fuck, I can't go to the next one.
The previous. All right, let's do this. Fuck it. All right, whatever. All right, go.
Fine. Never mind.
Sorry.
All right. This is a horror question.
Oh, boy. Okay.
Who has the highest body count? Michael Myers, Jason Voorhees, Freddy Krueger, or Leatherface? So, basically, he will be giving me one of those people, and so he has a 1, 2, 3, 4 in one chance of getting it right. 1 in 4. 1 in 4, rather. But, so basically, we'll start with Eric. Do you feel like Peter is going to get this one right or wrong, and how much weight? 1, 2, or 3 points in the right-wrong direction?
2 points he gets it right.
2 points he gets it right. Plus two.
And I believe in you, man.
Correct.
Okay.
All right. Hal.
Don't take this personally, but I'm going 3 against.
Okay.
I would. okay. Minus 3. Wrong. Mr. Kevin.
Let's see. Horror. So I could get it, but let's see. I think Pete. I'm going to go against for 1 point. I'm going to play it safe this round.
Okay.
Okay. He gets it wrong for 1 point. Right?
That is what I'm saying, yeah.
And Mr. Richard.
I'm going to go 3 against because when he was mentioning his Spanish enthusiasms, he never mentioned horror once.
Okay. That is correct.
Now, for Richard, it would be 3-4.
Yes.
That's yes.
Richard would know
absolutely.
This.
Absolutely.
All right, Peter, what is your answer for the question? Right. Who has the highest body count, Myers, Voorhees, Krueger, or Leatherface?
Okay, so Krueger takes too long, I think. He takes forever. He savors his kills. So he usually averages about 8 or 9 a movie or something like that, I think. Michael Myers... again, he takes forever. He chases people down. It's always running, and there he is, and then he's not, and then he is.
With the running and the...
And who was it? Was Leatherface was the other one?
You got Voorhees, Myers, Krueger, and Leatherface.
Yeah, and Leatherface, I don't think it's Leatherface either, because he can only kill people that come to him. Like, they have this house way out in the woods. You can only kill, like, 5 people to go, right? So I'm going to have to say it's Jason. I think Jason Voorhees is our top killer.
That is correct. You are right. That would mean that...
Damn engineering skill.
Eric is up by 2. And yes. Hal is down by 3. Kevin is down by 1. And Richard is down by 3. All right. Peter, yes. I'm going back to near the center. Tell me if you want to go up, down, or stay on the same page.
Let's go up. Scroll up.
Scroll up. And you say when.
When.
When. All right. And this is in this, I can tell this is in this category of pop culture. You can pick between.
Uh-oh.
1 and 12.
All right, let's do 6.
6. All right. Your question, Peter, is what was the name of the 1983 cartoon featuring the animated Rubik's Cube.
Okay, I'll give it a go.
And I must have the answer in the entire title and subtitle.
I got you. I want you guys to know I was alive during this time and watching cartoons.
Wait, what year was this?
1983.
I was 13.
All right, I'll give it to you. 13.
So, but Mike is asking for the very specific title. So,
yes.
I think all I right. remember it. Maybe.
Eric.
Maybe.
How confident are you, say you, what say you, being that you're up by two?
I still believe in you. I'm going to go 2-4.
Yes. 2.
Going to get it right for 2 points.
Correct.
Okay.
Mr. Hal.
I like to chase death. I'm going -3 again.
-3.
You got to have one of the guys like me in this game.
Yeah, right.
Kevin.
All right. So, obviously, last round I missed that one. Let's say I'm going to go 2-4. I'm going to take Eric's approach on this one.
You sell out.
Two correct. Believe. There are no sellouts in Cube of Death. Trust me. Mr. Richard.
How many rounds are there in this game?
We're doing 4 rounds, so this is the second of 4.
Okay, well then I gotta get back into it. I'm gonna go 3 that he knows it. Okay.
3.
Wow.
That he gets it correct. Peter.
Richard, I hope I don't let you down. But then again, Hal, I hope I don't let you down either.
Oh, thanks, buddy. Disappointment is my win.
Well, here's the beauty. I can't cheat because I either know it or I don't. Right.
And the best part is, his made-up answers are so much better than the right ones, it's worth the price of admission. Go ahead, Pete.
Well, yeah, okay.
Go ahead,
Pete. Gonna break.
All right, yeah. I think the name of this, I think, was Rubik and His Amazing Friends.
Well, you would think that, and if you were the one who thought that, you would be the one who would be wrong. Because it actually was Rubik, the Amazing Cube.
Oh, rat shit. Okay.
You know, the animated Rubik's Cube.
He's so square, he doesn't have any friends. Come on, man.
I think you were thinking of Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends.
I don't know.
Yeah, right.
That was a card.
All right. That leaves us with Eric up now by 4. And that is how
the negative. Listen, only one who won on that.
I'm back
was
down
me.
To 10.
Yeah, Eric's
I'm back
at 10.
Down to 10.
I'm back to 10.
No, I'm giving you do your own addition and subtraction from whatever you have. I'm telling you what you're up or down by. That's the amount of space I have on my little piece of paper here.
Well, he's at 0 then.
No, Eric's 10, Hal is at 10, Kevin is at 7, and Richard's at 4.
All right, Mr. Know-it-all. You want to be
I'm used to keeping score. That's all right.
Do it. Do it.
Okay. Do it. Right, come on,
do
Mike.
It. Let me do it. What do you want to do? Same. I've gone up, or up around somewhere. You want to go up, and you say me when to stop.
Stop.
Good, because it just had happened to stop. All right. This is. Hold on one sec. We are into fantasy. And the question is, what is the name? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, no. Yeah. Here it is. The question is, what is the name of the mythical five-bladed weapon used in the movie Krull?
Krull.
Well, you were alive for that one, too.
I was. I've seen this movie a bunch of times, but I don't think I've seen it since... before 2000.
But then again, also, that is a very geeky name of a weapon.
Oh, was it?
All right, Eric, what do you say? What's
right, I'm locked in. Like, locked in.
Still believe in you. 2-4.
2-4. Not going against his grain. Speaking of going against his grain, Hal, how you doing?
Hey, buddy. I'm going to go two against.
Two against?
Bring it, Hal. Bring it.
Time, huh?
I just, my gut says he's close, but no bananas.
Oh, okay.
All right, Kevin.
Three against.
Three against. Man, nobody loves you, man.
I got to pick up Hal's slack.
Mr. Eric Lee. Loves me. Eric has got me every time.
Believe in you.
Mr. Lee.
Three against.
Three against.
If you didn't know Rubik the Amazing Cube, my God.
What does he know? You've lost our respect, sir.
See, my awakened familiar cube believes in you as well.
Okay.
And just for shits and giggles, not that I'm a betting man or anything, but I think he knows this one. But that's just because he's my little buddy.
I think I know this one.
Oh, that's what'll kill you in this game. Oh, if I know it, he knows it. But anyway, go ahead.
I still chose against him, if you know.
Mike?
Yes?
I believe that their magical weapon was called a glaive.
Damn it.
Oh, yeah.
damn it. I did know it, and so did he.
I may have played a character with one of those at some point.
Yes. That's how you remember things.
Yes. Right.
I think at 13, we all had a glaive, didn't we?
Or we had two blades.
And a sun sword, yeah.
All right.
What school of wizardry does your wizard pursue? Trigonometry? Good answer. No, just saying.
All right, Pizza, where are we now? Give us our at the
Eric
end of
has
round
12,
three.
Hal has Ooh. 8, Kevin has 4, and Richard has 1.
And Richard has what?
Right where I want him.
Right?
Richard has how much?
1.
1.
Uno.
He's dancing on the death of the cube.
On the razor's edge. That's right.
I think you should let us bet up to 6 on this round.
Oh, wow. Up to 6.
Yeah, let's do it, Mike.
Yeah, whether you have it or not.
All right, and
Al
Mike,
just wants to win. I get it.
No, I just want Richard to have a chance.
No, it's going to be – this is what it's going to be. So we're going to do, Mike. You can bet up to 3, and it'll be a double damage.
Oh.
Okay.
So if I get them both right you can bet up to 6 and it'll be a double damage. Let's put it that way. Let's do that, Mike.
Okay. I'm going
to
find
you. Shoot down to near the end of the document. Pick something at the end.
I'm sure.
Or not at the very end, but somewhere near the end.
You know, the hard ones.
No.
Something outside of the
80. After you got past all the obvious questions.
Right.
Give him something in the 2015s, like twerking or
Shatterrun. Shatterrun trivia. Come on.
Right. You can pick something from role playing, wherever. Just pick something.
Okay, here we go.
GURPS.
This GURPS. Is mythology.
Ooh. Oh shit!
Interesting.
I know mythology. All right.
All right.
You heard it here first,
ooh,
gentlemen.
Okay.
He knows mythology.
I know some mythology. Mythology. Oh. She was a teacher. I had no guy.
Yes. All right. Speaking of mythology. How many sisters did Medusa have?
Ooh, okay.
And I guess, how does this work? I ask you the double damage question now.
Let them bet. You can bet up to 3 and then you can double down whether I'm going to get double or nothing, whether I'm going to get it.
Okay. So, let's three, go in.
Three emails it.
What's it? Three I have.
Three? Uh-oh.
I could just say no bet and play it safe with my score, but go big or go home. Three emails it.
That's right.
Okay,
all
Jeopardy.
Right. Hal?
Well, come on. It's me. I'm going 3 against.
Okay.
True to form, Hal. True to form.
Kevin?
And I'm a very positive person, but for some reason... I'm just going negative tonight.
Pete just rubs you the wrong way. I understand.
He's positive. He's wrong.
All right, Kevin. All right, what do you say?
Kevin?
I'm going to say 3 that he gets it right.
Okay. He gets it right.
And Richard, we'll let you go negative. Go for it.
Oh, okay. Well, then I will bet the maximum that he knows it.
Okay.
You betrayer, Richard.
All right. So we go this, and then we double down afterwards, Pete?
No, because a lot of times a double damage question has to do reveals the first answer. But, you know, I've already written it down.
Okay, so what is all right, so the second question is, what were their names? Jesus, yeah. I can't even read that.
All right, I doubled down and he's got it.
Wow.
Yeah.
I wish you had that much faith in me.
I have that much faith in you, buddy.
I'm just kidding.
Get the questions right.
Not in the hot seat.
Because I'm
locked. I'm locked in. Who's doubling down?
Eric said he's doubling down for you, man.
That I know. Okay.
Yeah. There's no doubt that Hal's doubling down against you.
I'm the antithesis of Eric, so I'm going to say he doesn't know that I'm doubling down.
Okay. Kevin?
Kevin?
All right, so if I double down, it has to be for my original, right? Saying that he knows it?
Not necessarily.
No, you can double down and say I don't know it.
Well, all right, you know what? I'm not going to double down. I'm going to stick with just my three and see if I can let the others fall.
All right.
All right, so you're just betting Richard? Zero. Okay,
yeah,
Richard?
I am going to double down that he does not know it.
Game theory.
Welcome back to the dark side, Richard. Welcome.
All right.
Good old game theory, Richard. All right.
All right. Let's do this, Mike. You ready?
All right. How many sisters does Medusa have, Peter?
She has two.
That is correct. Two sisters.
Yep, that is correct.
I would not have known that. I would have said one sisters.
Yep.
I couldn't even. I'm so dumb, I wouldn't have even gotten the clue. What are their names? What are their names, Peter?
All right. But their names were Miss Ology. And Miss Knowledge.
I knew it.
I have no fucking idea what their names are.
That seems legit.
So, Eric, you tumbled down to six.
That's fine. It was worth it.
Hal? Oh, Hal, you're down. Wait a minute, hold on. Tumbled down, I didn't know it.
So I'm up three.
You're up three. Yes, you are. So that gave you that. Very good. Kevin, you stuck. So that gave you that. And Richard, you did very well, Richard. All right. The final scores. We have an upset. We have an upset. Eric, you were left with six. Kevin and Richard tie for seventh. And Hal, you're our winner at 11.
Woo!
Very
negative nice. Always wins, kids.
Nicely played. Nicely
played. See, I have faith in you, Hal.
All right. Yep. So we, Mike, we do have a little, twerking. Tweaking to do on this on this game, but I think it's good live. I like it.
Okay, I think it'll work too. Yep.
All right, gents. Well, thank you for playing the game with us, and thank you for coming on, everybody.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah. This. Our show gets cut into two pieces, so there's the interview and there's the game. So let me go through this real quick. Make sure to check out the Awaken 2 Kickstarter. It starts
Thursday, 23rd.
Thursday the 23rd. Sorry, I threw that piece of paper down. The 23rd. It runs for 30 days. Please go book it. Book it. Please go back it.
and then get your book it.
Right.
Buy my
rewards are starting at $5 and moving up from there. And $5, that gets you the PDF, right? The book.
It gets you the ebook and the comic.
The comic. And they sent me a copy of the comic to preview, and it is very nice. It's worth it. The comic alone is worth $5, I think.
Oh, thanks, buddy.
So it's very nice.
Even though I didn't bet on you, I appreciate that you still support it.
And I just,
that's all right.
I just want to point out real quick that Pete, Mage Strike in the chat room, if you'd have just watched the chat room, she gave you the entire dissertation all about Medusa.
I purposely did not look at the chat room because during the game, people comment on the chat room and being that I'm playing, I ignored it.
You're a hell of a guy. You're a hell of a guy. But thanks, Mage Strike.
Yeah, man. Or Mage Strike. Sorry, I'm some Mega Strike.
And actually, Mage Strike is our editor and a very good friend of ours, Warren. So, hey, Warren. Okay.
Hey, Warren.
Should come on and play Cube of Death sometime.
I'm sure he'd be very good at it, actually.
Ah, sweet. Because I do another. There's another. Just to throw this out there, because now that we're part of the TSR podcast network, we're getting ready to transition in a couple days, but whatever. We're there. By the time you're hearing this, we're there. We have another one of the other podcasts on that network. It's called Cube of Death, and it's a game much like this game. It's quite a bit different. We actually have the contestants or characters and stuff like that. Make sure you check out cubeofdeath.com. You can find the podcast there, or go to tsrpn.com, and you can find it there. And it's a podcast. Correct. You can listen to it. It's fun.
Yes. There's also a pub version of this game if you buy the cards.
Yeah, well, I'm working on that. That old version is we're going to replace that old version.
That's all right. It's going to be good.
Yeah, it's going to be great. Okay. Hold on, Mike. I did it again.
What, did you stop the stream?
Oh. No, I didn't. No, I did not. You can't stop the stream, man. all right. I'm ready to go.
Yeah, you sure?
I'm ready, buddy. Let's roll those bean credits. You've just enjoyed another awesome episode of the Mythwits. A special thanks goes out to Hal, Richard, Kevin, Doug, who wasn't here, Eric. Sorry, this was written beforehand. And Richard and everybody else. Kevin, and did I miss you? Anyway.
And David and Mage Strike and everyone else in the chat room.
Yeah, thank you, Mage Strike. Thank you, David. Join us for a live broadcast. You can tell this is live. Mondays at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time to catch the full show. Jump into the chat room and ask our guest questions like our fine folks in our chat room tonight. If you miss our live show, you can always catch the encore episodes and the podcast version. Don't forget the podcast version at our website and on iTunes. You can find our website at mythwits.com, and you can visit us on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Do the like, follow, subscribe thing wherever it's appropriate. Please give us a ton of stars and review us on iTunes. It's pretty important. Mythwits is a S3E24.com production. It's protected under a Creative Commons license. You can download and share it with whomever you like. Just don't change. Is it whom or whoever? Is it whoever or whomever?
Whomever.
Was it?
Yeah, whomever.
Whomever. I got to change this. Yeah, I got to read it.
Whatever you'd like.
Right. Just don't change it. And don't try to make money with it, because we don't and you can't. Make sure to check out S3E24.com for more cool stuff, and join our mailing list and check out TSRPN.com. Our live episodes are edited into bite-sized bits released on the following week. Right, Mike? Interviews are on Mondays, Myth Bits on Wednesdays, and Game Time, like we just played, on Fridays. Thanks, everyone, for listening. Tell your friends to tune in, and until next week.
Mom, I gotta go to bed. Tired.